certainly appreciate you being with us today. I want to share with you now, you know, we have our Annie Armstrong Easter offering that we're taking up for our missionaries here in the United States. We set a goal for $3,500. We've already gotten $2,500. And with what came in today in Sunday school, we're now over the 3,000 mark already. That's 2 weeks. $3,275. Y'all reckon y'all got another couple thousand with you? Now y'all know we never satisfied with just getting what it says. We always got to have more. Because you can't ever give more to the Lord than you ought to give him. I'm going to tell you that right now. God is good, and he's been good to this church. And we need to thank him about supporting the missionaries and those that are out there. That's how you thank him for that. So we still got a couple weeks to Easter, so we ought to knock the socks off of that thing in the next couple, 3 weeks. If y'all help me out a little bit, okay? All righty then. And I got a little story I want to share with you of somebody that one of our missionaries that is supported by this. And it's a missionary whose name is Jacob and Francine Zillin. Now, these folks are out in California. Need a lot of missionary work done in California. right? I got to be careful. Y'all got to understand this. And this might get it again, but it's okay. I got kicked off of Facebook and YouTube Wednesday night. Whatever, I don't know nothing about no Facebook jail. All I know is they tried to explain it to me the other day. So that may get me kicked off again. If you get another little email from them, Dwight, just...
You put me in Facebook jail.
Oh, did I? Oh, man. That's right. They didn't like the words in it. They put it off. But anyway... Don't really matter to me. Anyway, I'm here to preach to y'all. But anyway, in California, but I just joked about California. Ain't a state in the world don't need revival. I can tell you that right now. So let's, you know, we cut up with that stuff. But Jacob and Francine Zalen are out in California. Their church sent them out there because there's a great need. And one of the great needs that we see in this country, too, is drugs. Drugs. We hear about it every day on the news. And so their church sent them out there. Listen to this. Jacob, the guy that's going out there as a missionary, he got saved while he was in jail. Brother Jay, you know something about that. Brother Jay's got a jail ministry that he does, and he's had plenty of people saved. Well, this was a young man that got saved while he was in jail. And now he's trying to help others who feel like they've been forgotten or they don't know anything about the love of God. So as part of his church's ministry, they give free food. They help with meals. And during the pandemic, Jacob and his family would put tables up in his driveway, and they would put fruit and vegetables and stuff so that people that were having difficult times in their life could come by there and get something to eat. Jacob helps the people he leads to find Jesus in recovery from the drugs and the alcohol. He connects them to a Christian recovery ministry. The church has opened a residential program. They're trying to help those that cannot find a place to stay, to help them find a place to stay for up to a year. That's quite an effort. And let's be honest about it. We might not always agree with all those things that people do, but there's a great need in this country for people to understand that nobody ever cared for them like Jesus cares for them. Even though he may be a long way off, nobody ever loves us like he loves us. And we need to, and those people that don't have much love from anybody, we can let them know that. So if we had to come back tonight, be with us. I'll be preaching on lying preachers tonight. So, or lying prophets, as it calls them in this country. Same thing, different time. I might make it 5 minutes in the disc tonight if I'm still on there. But anyway, you come back tonight because there is such a thing, I promise you. All right, let's do that. Mimi, you come and lead us in our open, our worship hymn. We've come into his house. Let's sing that this morning to open our worship service up. Thank you, church. Thank you, Mimi. Let's forget about ourselves and worship him, Christ the Lord. All right, children, y'all come on up here. I got a little story to start with you this morning. There you go. Wow. Yeah, I like that. Well, good morning. Y'all doing all right this morning? Sleep good last night? Good. Oh, my goodness, they're still coming. Wow. Well, let me ask you something. Last week I told you about Noah and the ark. I want to tell you about somebody else this morning that you may not or you may know of. There was a man in the Bible whose name was Abraham. Anybody here ever heard of Abraham? Okay. Abraham was in the Bible. And one day, God came to Abraham and said this to him. I need for you to move. I need for you to get your family and all your belongings and everything you have, pack them up. And it's like, you know, we got a lot of people in the church that camp and stuff. And what God is kind of saying to him, we're going on a camping trip. Just take everything you got with you. And Abraham asked him, what would the question somebody say, well, just load up and let's go. What would be one of the questions you'd ask him? Where are we going, right? Where are we going to? God said, just follow me. You don't need to know where you're going, but I'll tell you when you get there. So because he believed God would do what's best for him, Abraham does what? He packs his wife, his family, all of his belongings up, and he leaves, and he listens to God to tell him where to go at this time. So he says, we're going to have to leave the country and go to another country completely that you've never been to before. Now, the country that you're going to is not a very good country. Matter of fact, they don't even worship like you do. They have all kinds of different worship down there. They worship false gods and stuff like that. So, you got a choice. Are you going to trust what God says to lead you somewhere where you don't know going and you just load up and follow God? Or Are you going to say, I can't go until you tell me where I'm going? That's the thing that you have to deal with. Now, it was a long trip. They traveled for a long time. They didn't have buses or cars. They had donkeys and camels. So to go to a long, long place, we loaded everything, it took a terribly long time for them to get to where they were going to. And so when they got into this place, something happened. There was a famine in the land. You know what a famine is? It's where there's not enough. Go ahead, honey, tell me.
When you have lots of people that are in your family.
That's right. That's your family. And there's no food for them. So they follow God, and they go to where God tells them, and they stay there for a while, and all of a sudden, the grocery stores are closed. Can't get any food. So Abraham and his wife, Sarah, they go down into Egypt, where word has come to them that there is food for them there. And they go down there. Now, I'll tell you about the rest of that next week, but the thing I want to ask you today was this. Why do you think that they left their home and followed God, not knowing where they were going? Why do you think they did that?
Because they trusted God.
Amen. That's exactly right. They trusted God. That he would take them, and not only that, but that he would take care of them. Because why? He had told them that he would take care of them. So, it was not easy going through this. But when you find the rest of the story as we move along, you'll find that what? That God did everything that God told them he would do for them. And not only that, some years down the road, God was going to do one of the greatest miracles in the Bible through Abraham and his wife Sarah. Because they did what? Trusted God. That's right. We can trust God. Okay? All right, let's pray. Lord, I thank you, God, for these children. I thank you for the parents, grandparents, those that have brought them this way today. Lord, I pray now as they go back to their classes, God, that you would be with them and bless them as they leave and go back. Lord, I pray as they grow up, that God, that you might lead them like you did Abraham. And God, that they might trust you enough that God, they will follow wherever you lead them. Lord, bless them, bless their homes, for it's in Christ's name that we do humbly pray. Amen. All righty, let me get you some candy. Now, y'all might have a famine in y'all's house. Did y'all get breakfast this morning before you came? Y'all ain't hungry? You hungry? You hungry too? And you eat breakfast? She ate a lot of breakfast. Okay. She said you don't need nothing. You already eat a lot. But we not listen to her. We go eat anyway. Right? There you go. Now. This is what you call brunch here. This is what you get between breakfast and lunch. So I'm going to feed you brunch, okay? It's called a Tootsie Pop. There you go. All right. Who's got it? Go with Clayton and Brooke. They'll take you back. Let's have our morning prayer and for our offertory, and then Mimi will come and lead us in our song, Have Faith in God, and our ushers will come take up our offering. Let's pray. God, I thank you, Lord, that we can come into the house of God today. Lord, I thank you give us the Lord's Day to set aside, as that first song we sang, and set aside the cares of this world, and God, focus on you for this next 45 minutes or so. God, we thank you for the great love you gave us by dying on the cross for us, for rising up that first Easter Sunday morning. And you said that because I live, you shall live also. God, that's one of the greatest promises that you ever gave in the Bible. Lord, I pray today as we come here to worship, God, that we might lift up your name. I pray, dear God, that if there's someone here, Lord, that needs some comfort, that they've come to the right place. If there's someone here today that needs a relationship with you and do not have it, they've come to the right place. If there's someone here that's got a burden for somebody on their heart today and they want to take them to you, they've come to the right place. God, I just pray that what we do is we'll get ourselves out of the way, and God, we might see Jesus in this service today, that we might see him, as the Bible says, high and lifted up. God, I pray now that the Holy Spirit will come and control and lead. For it's in Christ's name we do humbly pray. Amen. Have faith in God. You stand with us, please, hymn number 405. Amen. Thank you, church. Thank you, Mimi. This time, Miss Lisa's had to call her on a moment's notice yesterday and see if she could sing. This morning already had her for the night, but had a little interruption, and Lisa was wonderful enough to go ahead and sing this morning. So, Lisa, you come and sing for me.
day a crowd stood face to face with a holy God of every race. A final chance for them to humbly but as their king was crucified, no tears of sorrow filled their eyes as they cursed his name and spat upon his brow. They should have cried, "Holy, worthy," as loud their voices raised. They should have cried, "Master, we surrender to your will and to your way." Instead, they cried, "Crucify, let him die, let's take his life away." They should
Easter's around the corner, can't you? Mm-mm, thank God for an Easter Sunday morning, which without we'd have really no reason to be here today, but we're not for that. All right, if you have your Bibles, I'm gonna, you know, we, for those that may be visiting, I've been doing a study in the book of Hebrews for several months now, and we're in the fourth chapter. I think we're into some of the most powerful verses of Scripture that are in the Bible. They're powerful verses of Scripture in this book. The last two Sundays, I preached to you on where it said that God's Word is sharper than a two-edged sword, that it has power, that God's word is more quick and it's powerful. And we talked about the word of God. But I want to share with you, let's look at, I don't know how far we'll get today, but we'll quit somewhere. And but I just wonder, if you have your Bibles and you've found the book of Hebrews in the fourth chapter, I want to read you some three very powerful verses of Scripture. Let's begin with verse 14 as we read these three verses of Scripture. The Bible says, "Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, so let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but in all points tempted like we are, and yet without sin. So let us," who's he talking to now? Us. "Because of what we just read, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we might obtain mercy and find grace to help in a time of need." Father, I thank you for the promises of the Word of God. Lord, I thank you for that first Easter Sunday, that Friday when you died on the cross, and that Sunday morning when they come and the tomb was empty, God, and as this scripture said, that you returned up into heaven to be with your Father later on. God, had there been no resurrection, this would mean nothing here, what we just read today. But because you rose up out of that grave, and it says now that you sit at the right hand of the Father up in heaven, God, we are people here that have hope now because of what that scripture said. Jesus, we thank you for what you did for us. God, I thank you for what you do for us every day, walking with us and taking care of us, God. You let us get up today. You let us come to church. God, may you be honored and glorified in all that we say and do. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If 2,000 years ago you went to church, I promise you it would be nothing like what you're doing today. 2,000 years ago would have been totally different. Because see, if you were an Israelite, you would go into Jerusalem where the great temple was. And when you would get in there to the temple, the first thing that would be different is this. You would have been here yesterday, not today. Why? Because the Jews worshiped on the Sabbath, which is Saturday. So it would have been a different day when you would have come. You see, as we gather in a building like this, most of the time in the cities of Israel, the temple was built in the middle of the city where all the people could come and they could worship in that city. But how would it be different? If you had gone to worship then, you would not be sitting in a pew. You'd be standing against the wall. They had no pews for you to sit in. Also, ladies, y'all would probably be over there in a room outside of this room. Listening. Men would be over here. Gentiles would be out yonder on the outer court somewhere. We would not be all sitting here together today in worship if you had come back then. Then they would come in what would be a priest. You saw that in the scripture. They had a priest, and he would come in, and he would take the sacrifices. And he would burn them, do whatever was necessary. You would bring that lamb or that dove or whatever and get sacrificed. He would take care of that. And then once a year, they had a guy who was known as the high priest. And once a year, he would come, and in the back, they had a room. It had the Ark of the Covenant in it, had curtains in front of it, and you couldn't go there. The priest couldn't go there. The only one that could go in there was the high priest. Because then he would do a sacrifice in there for you and I, or those people that were back there then. And what he did was good for 1 year. Then next year, he would come to church, and he would show up again. Because every year, you needed that year's sins forgiven. That's the way they worship. You see the difference in then and now in the worship service? In our scripture today, it mentioned the priest. It mentions the high priest in the scripture today. And this verse tells me that when Jesus came and he died and he rose and 40 days later that he went to heaven, the Bible says that when he went up there, he was our high priest. It says in that scripture, seeing then that we have a great high priest, that's Jesus that he's talking about here, that is passed into the heavens. Where's Jesus sitting at today? Where's he at today? Sitting at the right hand of the Father. Isn't that what the Bible says? So he's left. He came to this earth. He left this earth and he passed. And now he sits up in heaven, sitting at the right hand of the Father. He sits in heaven, Jesus, the Son of God. So let us hold fast to what we profess. Now, for we have not a high priest that cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. Jesus Christ went through much of the things that we go through in this life. And so when you pray, you see, we're taught sometimes in the world that you and I live in. And this, for me, this is totally wrong about this. On the matter of prayer, there are many churches, many large, some of the largest denominations in the world that believe this, that in order for me to get my sins forgiven, that I have to go talk to the priest. And then he goes to God for me and asks God to forgive me of my sins. That is not true. That is not true. If that's true, then you need to tear this out of your Bible here, because that is not what this says. It says, we do not have a high priest that does not feel what we do. Jesus is the high priest. Now, who is he dealing with here? The book of Hebrews. Who's he talking to? Jews, right. Why? Because there's a problem in the church there, where the Jews were converted and became Christians at the time Jesus was here. Now, in this scripture, see, Jesus is gone. He's up in heaven. He's the high priest. Now that Jesus is not here, this is what's going on. The Jews are wanting to go back to the old ways of going to church and the priest coming in doing the sacrifice, and then once a year the high priest come and getting away your sins in. But the Bible tells me that is an unnecessary thing and does not apply to the church world today. No. I don't care what they say. That is wrong if you do not believe that we have a high priest that we can go. The last verse of that scripture says, since he's on the throne, our high priest Jesus, that knew sin, what does it say to me and you? Therefore means what? What happened before this verse? Since it called him a priest, it called him the high priest, he's sitting on the throne. It says, therefore, since this is true, he deals with us. He says, therefore, come boldly unto the throne of grace. He didn't say, go boldly to the priest, did he? He didn't say wait on the high priest once a year to come and forgive your sins. He says, therefore, since Jesus is the high priest, and you know, when Jesus rose, or when he died on that cross that day, The Bible says, you see, it's just almost like that baptismal pool right there. You can't see it from here, but there is a curtain behind there. Now, the Holy of Holies in the Bible was where the Ark of the Covenant, that was the place where the high priest went in, and there was a huge curtain in front of it. Nobody could go in there but him. But the Bible says that on the day that Jesus died, that curtain was torn down. It was ripped apart. That meant what? That anybody could go in there. So I don't have to go to a confessional booth to get my sins forgiven. I don't have to go to another preacher to get my sins forgiven. I don't have to go anywhere except to the throne of God, where the one that died for my sin sits today, and not only go to him, the Bible uses the adjective that says, go boldly to the throne. That means if you got a problem, get down on your knees and talk to the Lord about it. If you need help, get down on your knees and talk to Jesus about it. If you want to get saved, get down on your knees and ask him to save you. Be boldly. Don't not be afraid, because there's one up there that loves you more than anybody down here ever loved you, and his name is Jesus, because you're the reason he died. So therefore, my wife comes to me boldly, sometimes too boldly. But why does she do that? Because she knows I love her. She can ask me anything. It's that same relationship with Jesus. As I said in the beginning of this, nobody ever loved you like he loved you. Nobody ever cared for me, as that song said, like Jesus did. You see, when it's a matter of prayer, Jesus says this. Why does he say he sits at the right hand of the Father in the Bible? He explains why he's there. He says, I sit there to make intercession for you. Jesus said, I'm the high priest. Now, go back to the Old Testament now, to the Bible. The high priest would go and open that curtain. He was the only one could enter that room. And he did it for the sins of all the people, to forgive them. Same today. High priest is in heaven. He's up there for those of us that need to talk to him. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5 and 6 says this, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood has made us, listen to this now, this is key, he has made us kings and priests. Did you get that? He that loved us by shedding his own blood has made us priests. That we can go and talk to the high priest and talk to him and have. So this is one of the great things about being a Christian that they didn't believe in the Bible of that day that they had. And that is this. I have direct access into heaven today. Direct. I ain't got to call and get no answer machine. Ain't nobody going to say I'm going to call you back within 2 days. No. That old song says that line up to heaven, up to God, is never busy. It doesn't matter if there's 90 million people praying today, God hears it. That's our high priest. That's our high priest that he talks about in the scripture, the great high priest. Do you know that when Jesus is ascribed this title in the Bible, that he's the only person that was ascribed this title in the Bible? Nobody else. Nobody. But him was ascribed this title in the Bible. So therefore, we have a present time to talk with God, to be with God, for God to listen to our prayers, and that's what God does. Now, our high priest has left this earth, and he's passed into glory. And that's where he is right here in this scripture, in the ascension after he left. One of the biggest problems disciples had, and this was in my Sunday school lesson this morning, was understanding why Jesus had to go back to heaven. Our Sunday school lesson this morning taught this, that he told them that I'm going to die and I'm going to leave you. Peter said, that don't make sense, God. Why are you going to do that? Why? Nobody can take your life. Why are you going to do that? And they could not understand. And then they really got blown away when he said, in my Father's house are many mansions. He's trying to explain to them, calm them down, because they're afraid he's leaving. They're frustrated that he's going up to heaven where he is now. He's giving them a warning here. But he's also giving them encouragement that it's going to be okay with him gone, because we still can get in touch with him. Still can get in touch with him. It's kind of like my doctor. Miss Mary's retiring. But he told me the other day, if they need me, they can still get in touch with me. Jesus said, I'll be listening. But he said, I got to go. But when I go, I'm not just going to be gone. I'm going to be doing something. What do you think Jesus has been doing 2,000 years? Getting things ready in heaven for us to come home. Getting things ready. He said, if I go, I'll go and prepare a place for you, that where I am, you may be also. I'll be in heaven. That's where he's at. He's kept his word. You talk with him. Everybody ever prayed a prayer, and somehow or another, it might not have happened right in the time you wanted to happen, but sometime in your life, God answered that prayer and did something, so you knew there was somebody listening to your prayer. Well, I could go on and on about the answered prayer of God. And he's at the right hand of the Father, and that's where he is, and that's what he did for us. Verse 14 called him the Son of God. The Son of God. Jesus was the only person that ever lived on this earth that was totally human and totally God. Only one. Never been one like him, never will there ever be one like him again. There's only one Savior, there's only one way, because when you get through the other part of John, where he says, I'm going to heaven and prepare a place for you, the sixth verse says this, if I go. We had a discussion in Sunday school last week about that little word if in the Bible. Steve, I looked at up. There's a lot of ifs in the Bible, a lot of them. But what I learned is you got to understand the language where they come from, which was the Hebrew. And a lot of times, if can mean two things. It can mean when I go or since I'm going up there. That's what it can mean. Jesus said, if I go and I prepare a place for you, then I'll come back and get you one day. He's trying to do what? Comfort those guys. They're struggling. They're afraid. They don't know what they're going to do when he's gone. Ever been like that in your life where you wondered what you're going to do when you seem like you got to handle it all by yourself? That's where they were. But he said, I'll go and I'll prepare a place for you. And when time gets right, I'll come get you. In funeral services, I try not to use that scripture too much, because that's a scripture that most preachers use. I try to not do that, but I will refer to it. He said, if I go and prepare a place, I will come receive you, that where I am, there you may be also. So the truth of the matter is this. That when you leave this world and you're a child of God, what happens? The Bible says to be absent in this body is to be present with the Lord. And let me tell you something else the Bible says. That to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Interest in heaven is a lot better than anything you'll ever gain down here. God don't care about our money. He doesn't care about our wealth. He doesn't care what kind of house we live in, what kind of car we drive. God cares that we get to heaven. That's why he's there. That's why he's the high priest. He wants us to understand that that's who he is. And this is what I love about this. What this scripture says here is this. That whatever burden you carry, that whatever thing is beating you down, this is what I love. When he calls him our high priest, he get up in heaven, he been tempted like we are. Listen, we'd love to go through this life and it be painless, wouldn't we? Wouldn't it be great if you never had to shed any tears sometime? Folks, if you live very long, that ain't never going to happen in your life. I'm going to just tell you that right now. There's going to be pain sometimes. There's going to be tears. Well, why does Jesus care about why I'm crying? Because he's been through the same thing. He said we've got a high priest that's been through the same kind of infirmities. You know what he had to do? He had to deal with his best friend dying. Die. And he went to the grave and he went to the tomb where he was, and we know how he called him out, but the Bible says that he wept. We got somebody on the throne of heaven sees our tears. There's a song that says that tears are a language that God understands. Thank God we got a high priest up there that when we call him, tell him, excuse me, my life's falling apart. My marriage is messed up. My job is messed up. My kids are messed up. Whatever's going on in our life, that he's sitting up there and he says, ain't the first time I ever heard that. That ain't the first time I ever dealt with that. I know how to fix it. That's our great high priest. That's our faith. He uses that term in that last scripture. He says that we come boldly before the throne of God. That's where he said the high priest was. That's Jesus. And then he says, he called it a throne of grace. Where Jesus sits is a throne of grace. You know, one thing about Jesus in worship today than it was back then, that high priest had to go through that curtain how many times, I tell you, every year, to forgive me of my sins that year. But once Jesus forgives them, they're gone. Once Jesus forgives them, they're forgotten. Now the people that you might have sinned against, might have done something, they may remember, but I'll tell you right now, once Jesus forgives, Jesus forgets. That's the difference between him and us. I can forgive, but I can tell you right now, I ain't sure, it ain't easy for me to forget sometimes. If somebody has done me wrong, I'll just give you an analogy that I heard Preacher Junior Hill say one time. I was at a preaching conference, he was preaching. And he gave this analogy, talking about this kind of same thing. He says, one time I went to a church, he was an evangelist. He went around to churches and he preached in services. And he said, this is what would happen. And he's talking about the same thing I'm talking about. He says, if I would go into a church and I was walking in and people were shaking my hands and this woman shook my hand, and I said, you about the ugliest woman I ever seen. She might forgive me and I'd apologize. If I went back there next year and the next year and the next year to preach, every time she walked through that door, what would she remember? And I said she was ugly. forgive me, but you would never forget it. That's the difference between God and us. God can forgive those things. He doesn't hold things against us. Once he forgives us, it's said and done, and it's over with there. That's our high priest that sits up into heaven that carries our burdens with him as we go through. Passed into the heavens. Let me wrap this up. Because he forgives and forgets. This is the fact of life that people don't like to deal with, but this is just a fact of life. Now, I'm a guy that believes the Bible. I believe every word that's in that thing. I'm just telling you. Every word. Good, bad, and ugly. I like it all. I love it all. But God, we must all one day, and this is what people don't, I believe if people really understood this, they wouldn't act the way they act sometimes. If people really understood this, they wouldn't be as crazy as they are in the world we live in today, and the world would not be in the shape it's in today. But I'll tell you why it's in the shape it's in today, because people don't believe what that book says. They do not believe that there's a judgment day coming. They just believe that all this will be pushed aside, they'll be okay. They've listened to Oprah Winfrey tell them that everybody's going to go to heaven, so they believe that crap, and that ain't true. They ain't going to heaven. They forget this one most important thing. Y'all hear me say this a lot because y'all hear me preach. I don't know a lot, so I have to keep repeating the same thing sometimes. This. Everybody got to talk with God one day. I don't care who you are. I don't care what color you are. I don't know what state you live. I don't care what country you live. I don't care what century you lived in. Start with Adam and Eve. And go to the last person that lives. And I'll tell you one thing. The Bible says every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that he is God. So therefore, everybody's got to meet God one day. People forget that. I think sometimes when people are fixing to do crazy things and hurt somebody, do something, they've never been taught that, never heard that. And that's the sad fact, because I'll tell you why. Most people don't go to church today. Let me tell you something. Y'all are a rarity today. While y'all been in here, they've been 10 times that many people rode up and down that road out there. Church ain't on their mind. That's the world we live in today. 82% of the world today has no church affiliation. So that'll kind of explain to you why we're moving in the direction we in, won't it? Sure. Generation Z, know about them. But Generation Z, my generation was known as the hippie generation. I tell you this. Last week, I believe, my wife loves tie-dyed shirts. She still loves tie-dyed shirts. We were raised up in the 60s, 50s. That's when Woodstock and all that came along. But I'm glad that somewhere along the way she got me to going to church. I never went to church till I met her. Maybe like most people, once on Easter, maybe at Christmas time, but just to go to church on Sunday, we didn't do that. That lady there got me to going to church. Had an aunt that I couldn't stand. And I'll tell you why. That's a lie. I could, Lynn. Don't be mad at me. And I tell you this story. I tell you, I don't know a lot of new stories. I'm old. I can't remember a lot of stuff. But every time we'd walk in her house, I wasn't even going to church then. But every time we'd walk in her house, she'd tell Lynn, she'd say, Brother Tommy, she'd say, that boy there's going to be a preacher. A preacher? I wouldn't go to church. And every time we'd go, I got where I didn't want to go because I got tired of hearing that mess. But that's what she'd say every time. Well, God hears prayers. You know why I'm saved today? Not because I deserve it. It says that we go to the throne of grace and mercy. Isn't that what that scripture says? That when we go to the throne there, it's for grace and for mercy. Nobody would be saved and on the way to heaven today if it weren't for God's grace and his mercy and his love toward us. But he said that yet while we were sinners, he died for me. When he was on the cross, as that old song says, I was on his mind. Thank God. And I realize that every knee's going to bow. Every tongue's going to confess. We're going to sit and we're going to kneel before that great high priest one day. Now, I don't know how this is. We've got a couple of preachers here that know more than I do. But this is what they say. This is what I've heard all my life, that we'll kneel before God and we'll give an account of our lives. Y'all ever heard that? That's what you got to do. Well, I never understood that. Because if I have to give an account of it, meaning that God didn't know what it was to start with, and I got to tell him. Nobody knows me like he knows me. He's watched me from the day that I was put in my mama's womb. The Bible said he knew me then. So what am I going to tell him that he don't already know? Nothing. Nothing. Ain't no need to sugarcoat it, try to make it better. Because Jesus already knows it. So as we close today and we go home, this is powerful scripture here. I'm just telling you the book of Hebrews will probably tell us more about Jesus, totally verse, verse, word, word, than any other book in the Bible. Any other book in the Bible. It's a hard book. It's the last book that I ever decided to teach some years ago because it was so hard I could not understand it. And I don't understand it all now. But I know one thing. I've got a high priest that will listen to me when I call. I got a high priest that knows me better than anybody in this church knows me. I got a high priest that I will have to go to one day and share it with him. But I'll not tell him anything you don't know. Therefore, let us come boldly unto the throne, not just any throne, but the throne of grace. There's an old saying, and it says this. I do crossword puzzles. I love to work crossword puzzles. I work them every day just about it. And one of the things they'll have in a crossword sometimes, it'll have the word worship, and then it'll have a couple blanks in it. Well, I've done enough of them over the last 20 years to worship from afar. That's what it is. In case you do a crossword and you get that, that's the answer. Worship from afar. And let's be honest, I just happen to think, that's what we're doing right now, aren't we? Aren't we worshiping from afar? He's way up yonder somewhere in a place called heaven. So we're worshiping from afar. But yet, we're still before the throne. Still before the throne up there. This is what I'll close with. The thing gives me the most comfort in this world is this. Jesus knows when my heart hurts. Jesus knows when I'm sad. And I believe this about him. When my heart hurts, his heart hurts. It's just like me. Now, he's my father, right? Children, is there anything breaks your heart more than when your child is hurt? There's nothing in the world like the pain of a child that's struggling. Life's a tough one. That's one of the most hurtful things to have to deal with in all of your life. I promise you've been there and done that. Well, that's the same way it is with me and God. I'm his child. And when I'm struggling and I'm hurting and I don't know what to do, he's hurting for me. That scripture I just read to you said, go before the throne boldly. The Bible says this, you have not because you ask not. You have not because you ask not. Who loves to hear from my children? I do. Lynn does. I love when that phone rings and it's one of my boys calling. And they've called with good news and they've called with bad news and I've called in with both. That's life. It's called family. I'm glad I'm in the family of God today. I'm glad I'm talking to one that knows when I hurt, he hurts. I'm glad that I'm talking to one that can fix what's going on in my life if he needs fixing. The question is asked in the Bible. I ask you this question sometimes. I say this. Is there anything you need God to do for you? How many times have y'all heard me say that? But there's a scripture in the Bible that says, and ask the question, is anything too hard for God? Is anything that I'm going to tell him or ask him, is it too hard for God to do something about? And of course we know what. The answer's no, isn't it? There's nothing too hard for my God. So that's why, Christy, I go before. Is it Cindy or Christy? I did her daddy's funeral the other week. I've been knowing this girl for umpteen dozen years. I call her Cindy. You ought to see the look on her face. I said, Ginger, Desiree, and Cindy. Will you ever forget that?
No.
Okay. See, that just proves a point I just preached.
I was going to shake your hand and say, my name's Cindy. Nice to meet you.
Wait. I like that. That's good. You don't got me messed up here. But he ain't never going to call you Cindy. He'll call you Chrissy. I make mistakes. He don't. You ain't even got to tell him who you are. You just call on him. I tell you right now, I got three boys. And they can call, and I don't have to look on that caller ID, but I can do what? Hear their voice, can't I? I know who they are. God's no different. So I want to ask as we close and have our invitation to him today. The question I ask you many times, what's going on that you need for God to do in your life? Is there something you need, a word, you need a comfort, you might need Jesus today, whatever. Nothing is too hard for God. I don't care what burden you're bearing today. I want to tell you something. My God can take care of that. And you remember, he said you have not because you asked. So what? I don't mind asking God for things. I'll ask him in a heart. My kids don't mind asking me for something. So why should I mind asking him for something? And that's the way I feel about it. Do what, Tom? Did you say something? Amen. That's right. Amen. Finally got an amen. All right. So we have an invitation. Mimi's going to come and lead us in our invitation hymn. And this is a word to let you know God loves you today. Not only that, he's on the throne watching you today. God knows every tear you ever cried. God knows your heart. He knows the pain you're going through. He knows if you're lonely, if you're hurting, you need something. Whatever you need, God already knows. Listen, you ain't going to call him and ask him nothing, tell him nothing he don't already know. So why not go? Nothing. If you need God today, you come and say, preacher, let's just pray. I don't care what you need. You don't need to tell me. But the Bible says this. If two or three are gathered in my name and agreeing on anything, I'll hear from heaven and I'll answer your prayers. God. got something you want to agree on today? Let's take it to it. Mimi, what was it, huh? Hymn number 309. Hymn number 309. Would you stand, please, and if God speaks to you and you need prayer or anything, I'll tell you, God's wide open listening now to us. Whatever you need, go to the throne boldly, as that scripture says. God, it's me again. But I'm here to ask you, God, or I'm here to whatever. And he said, thank you for coming. Last verse, one more verse, and here we'll go. God's speaking to you. You may not know what it is, but you just come and let's pray about it. Thank you for being here today. God bless you. You pray this week. You got something going. You talk to God about it. I'm telling you, he can fix that. He can handle that if you'll just take it to him. I can tell you that right now. Come back night, 6 o'clock, line preachers. You come back. You might hear one night. I don't know. But you come back. Mr. Richard, dismiss us with prayer.